Hi, I'm Graham Steele, CEO and founder of Cryptosense, and today I'm going to talk about quantum random number generation. Do we really need it? So first of all, we need to understand, how does random number generation work? For example, in our computer, when we're going to generate a cryptographic key for encrypting some data. So obviously it's very important that the value of that key is unpredictable. It's not possible for our adversary to guess what that value is going to be. So in practice, that works by two steps. First step is something called an entropy source. So this has to be something that is genuinely completely unpredictable. Even if we know what the system is from the outside, we're not able to guess what values are going to come out of it. So this typically relies on some kind of physical phenomenon. Okay, so it's not mathematics, it's something physical inside our machines. And it can be something to do with glitches in semiconductors, depending on little changes in the temperature. All kinds of particular physical phenomena are used to get this entropy source. So you've got this entropy source as something that's unpredictable, but typically that unpredictable value isn't a perfect uniformly distributed random number that we can use as a cryptographic key. So we have to apply, first of all, a technique to remove bias from the values, because normally we know what the bias is from the particular physical source. And then often this entropy source only produces these truly random bits at a very low rate, okay? So not enough for us to generate a whole bunch of cryptographic keys as we need them. So typically what we do is use the entropy source to create a seed value, and then we apply a pseudo-random number generator to that seed, and that's going to generate all of our cryptographic keys for us that follow. And actually that works fine. It sounds like there might be a problem with that because it's pseudo-random, not really random. But the point is, if you don't know what the seed was because of that entropy source, and you've got a good pseudo-random number generator that has a lot of state inside, so not just the last value that came out, but there's a whole bunch of state inside it that's working out what the next value is going to be. And you can keep seeding, the reseeding and adding to the entropy pool of the value that's being used in that pseudo-random number generator from your entropy source as it's able to generate bits, you can actually produce really good cryptographic keys that nobody in practice can break, and you can certify and statistically check this thing is working properly, and this is what is being used for the most critical keys that we're using all around the world without problems. So where does this new way of generating random numbers, the quantum random number generator, come in? Well, in fact, quantum random number generators are not in a way that different. So they're basically just another way of getting that entropy, getting that very unpredictable or completely unpredictable seed value that you need. The point about quantum random number generators is that if you build them right, you can make the entropy source so good and so far, so high bandwidth of values, that you don't need the pseudo-random number stage. You can actually just read straight from the quantum random number generator a stream of truly random bits that you can use for your key. So seeing as we already had a system for doing this, okay, it involved these two steps and whatever, and we had to make sure we got all those things right, but it was working fine. What's the advantage of this new way of doing it? Well, there are two problems in cryptography that this quantum random number generator could solve, and one problem that it definitely does not solve. So as you'll know, if you've been following our course on cryptographic failures, random number generation does go wrong in practice. And one of the ways that it goes wrong is what you might call a kind of cold start problem. Devices that are built and have to generate a key pretty soon after startup, but don't have enough randomness in their entropy pool. And so if I have, for example, 60 devices built exactly the same, let's say they're, network switches or something, they all boot up and they share some of their random numbers. So in particular case, in 2012, there was a paper about how the RSA keys generated by a whole bunch of similar devices actually shared primes, which allowed them to be factored and gave away the private keys and completely lost all the security. So you can see our talk about cryptographic failures to find out more about that. So that was a problem from 2012, but in fact, that problem is still there. Papers keep going back to survey the internet and look at keys that are generated, particularly on embedded systems, and finding that they still have problems with random number generating in a kind of cold start situation. And we're finding these shared factors and breaking keys still even now with products that have come out since 2012. So if there were a really cheap, easy to use quantum random number generator that we could put in any device and get a completely sure, straight from the go, really reliable random number generation, then that would actually be a good thing. That would remove a failure possibility that we see in some corner cases in cryptography today. There's another case, which is backdooring. So there was a very famous case of a backdoored random number generator that came to light in the 2010s with the Snowden revelations. Essentially, there was a method of doing the pseudo-random number generation. So this is the part that you do after you've got the entropy seed. That was happening in such a way that it would be impossible for somebody who knew some particular private values to look at the sequence of values and figure out what the next value was going to be. So that's how a backdoor would work in a pseudo-random number generator. And it turned out that the NSA were essentially paying the RSA security company to put this random number generator as the default option into their B-safe cryptography library that was being used everywhere. So this is a real problem, right? So we don't want it to be easy to distribute backdoors like that. And so a quantum random number generator doesn't need that pseudo-random stage because it's got this high bandwidth, pure, nicely, no statistical bias random number generator, at least in theory, if we can be sure that it's going to work. And so we don't need that stage. That makes it harder to put in one of these pseudo-random backdoors. Of course, in practice, we're much more attentive now to things like that because, you know, we've seen what can go wrong in the past. And of course, you can also backdoor hardware. There are instances of this, but that's clearly a lot more difficult than just giving a payment to a big corporation to put a backdoored bit of math in their library. So it would offer some protection against that. So quantum random number generators could help us eliminate some corner cases of where random number generation goes wrong in practice in cryptography. But bear in mind, we do already have certified ways of generating cryptographically secure random numbers that are well tested and have been used in practice for some time without problem when they're properly used. One thing that quantum random number generation does not solve is the problem of a large-scale quantum computer that's going to come along at some point and be able to break our asymmetric cryptography. And you'll know about that if you've seen our other videos on that topic. So sometimes it's suggested that when this kind of computer comes along, the old way of generating random numbers won't be good enough anymore. We'll need quantum random numbers to resist. So there's absolutely no reason to believe that. And you can read the FAQ on the NSA website, for example, that's very clear about this, that they don't have any intention of pursuing that as a way to resist quantum computing. There's no reason to believe that the current way we build random numbers will not be just as secure once there are quantum computing around. That's just not how these things work. Finally, there are possible applications for quantum random number generation that have nothing to do with cryptography. So some of CryptoSense's customers are very, very large banks, globally large banks who are interested in doing things like very complex simulations or Monte Carlo models of financial systems to figure out trading strategies and so on. And these require very high bandwidth, very high quality, really no bias random number generation for these models to work. Otherwise, some tiny, tiny bias might just flip some very complex part of this extremely complicated model in a certain state, and you might end up, you know, buying something that you should have sold. And so we do know that those corporations are looking into this. That's public information, in fact. And so that might find that it has an application there. But in the cryptographic field, they can be useful. Why not? But they should be seen as just maybe another way to do the random number generation that we already do, perhaps in a slightly smarter way. They're certainly not game changing, and they certainly don't change the way that we might need to resist quantum computing when that comes along. Okay, so please do subscribe to the channel to keep up to date with all the latest news on applied cryptography here at CryptoSense. You might want to follow our training course also on cryptographic failures to learn more about how cryptography goes wrong and how you can avoid it. Otherwise, I'll see you soon here for another video.